Hello and welcome to Tech Takshila. In this video, we will learn about distributed systems. So let's get started. Let's imagine a scenario that you are recently hired by, let's say, Google. Your manager introduces you to the team, and on your very first one-on-one, your manager is like, "Hey Alice, we have this project in our backlog for so long. So why don't you work on it?" The project is to design a simple microservice which does XYZ. So let's come up with a design and have it up for the panel review by next week. Now at this time, you are scared a little bit. You might be fresh out of college, or you were a full stack developer, so you might not be fully conversant with this concept. So just like any good engineer, you quickly go to the Google search engine and you start searching for how to design distributed systems. And trust me, you will get enormous amounts of results. Well, fortunately, you can use this video as a basic primer to introduce you to the concept of distributed systems. To understand distributed systems better, let's take a real-world example first for developing the intuition. Let's say you are an owner of a pizza company, Pizza Co. To first make a pizza, you need to set up a supply chain. You laid out the process as such. You need a pizza base. Then you need to add some toppings, in our case, let's say tomato sauce and some green peppers. You will then add some cheese on top of it. And then you will throw it in the microwave. After 5 to 10 minutes of the wait, your pizza is ready to be shipped or eaten. So you cut slices and you serve it. So as you can see, that there are many functions involved in making a pizza. You can take two approaches here. You can either have everything be done by one guy, or you can have multiple guys be taking care of individual pieces. So when you have one guy be responsible for making an entire pizza, we call it a monolithic architecture in systems world. And when you have multiple guys taking care of small but isolated steps in the entire chain, we call it a distributed systems, since we distribute the work. Let's understand what are the advantages of distributed systems. We can replace a person who is adding toppings if he or she falls ill on some day and keep the overall chain running. We can also increase the number of person who are baking the pizza, because baking and waiting for pizza to be baked in the microwave takes a huge amount of time as compared to just creating a pizza base and adding some toppings and cheese on top of it. So in this way, unlike a monolithic system where the same guy can't work on the other orders until the pizza hits up in the microwave, we distribute the work and multiple guys can put and take the pizza out of the microwave. So to understand distributed systems, you have to first hear it from the tech lords back in the day. Leslie Lampert, a famous computer scientist who worked at Microsoft Research for many years, once said, "A distributed system is one that prevents you from working because of the failure of a machine that you have never heard of." Andrew Tannenbaum, we know him as the inventor of Minix or as the granddaddy of Linux, said, "A collection of independent computers that appear to its user as one computer." Now let's look at the evolution of distributed systems. The need has trickled down from the long line of discussion on how to make one system more reliable, reusable, and available. But if you look closely, performance is at the core of all. Distributed system is not a new concept. We first saw the glimpse of it back in 1970s via ARPANET, who have created the world's first large-scale network partition distributed system. At this time, two paradigms of distributed system got introduced. One is to replicate and migrate mobile agent nodes, while the other was the class of client-server model that we know today. But as network communication got more advanced, it led client-server model to gain more popularity, which then gave way to SOAs, short for service-oriented architectures, that relied on simple remote procedure calls we all know as SOAP or Simple Object Access Protocol, finally paving the way for microservices. Now let's look at some of the common applications of distributed systems. First up is microservices. Next is distributed caching and distributed data storage. We will cover a lot more details about all of these systems in the later part of the video. But for the time being, to make a sense of all of this mumbo jumbo boring theory, let's first take a real world example. Let's say that you are about to design a favorite TV show voting system. So we have 10 popular TV series here, Friends, Young Sheldon, Game of Thrones, etc., etc. We will ask our viewers to vote for their most liked TV show that they watch. We need to build a system that lets the user cast their vote, and then at the end of the voting, we will show which TV series won the battle. So let's gather some requirements here. User should be able to use two platforms, that is mobile or desktop. Admins of the voting application should be able to access the current vote counts at any point of time. And the last one is that we are expecting a heavy load, such as the voting will last for a couple of hours. For example, we will receive about 1000 TPS at the peak time. At this point, we highly encourage you to pause the video and think how you would solve this problem. All right, I hope you did your due diligence to come up with at least the basic solution here. So let's see first what would be the naive approach to solve this problem. We can just quickly write a Django app that does all the things for us. It first gets the voting request from the user, then it authenticates the user who is voting, and in the end, it locally dumps the vote into a DB file. So let's look at some of the pros and cons for this application. Pros would be pretty straightforward. It is less time to write the software, easy to deploy, and horizontally scale by replicating the code onto more nodes. But there are some glaring downsides to this approach. It is pretty hard to scale and extend. There is no backup strategy, so if this server node goes down, then all the vote count will go down with it. Another potential con would be that it might overwhelm the server since it is doing a lot of stuff at the same time. It is authenticating the user, receiving the request, updating the DB file, all in one application. So it would be pretty hard for the EC2 machine or whatever the server node that the application is running on. So we should break down the entire process into two subcomponents. First is online component, aka data plane, and the second would be offline component, aka control plane. Let's see one by one what each of these mean and how they fit in the picture. So first of all, let's break down the online component. So let's start with the customers. Customers can use mobile as well as desktop platform to cast their vote. Network calls to cast the vote would be made over HTTPS, and the first line of contact would be the load balancer. This is after a request travels through the entire internet and after a customer presses submit or vote button on our voting page. The primary function of this load balancer is to use some sort of optimized scheduling algorithm and forward that request to a line of application servers, which will do the further storing of the vote. All right, after a request is forwarded to the application servers, we need to zoom in and see what really happens to persist the vote. The best option that comes to my mind is to use some sort of a NoSQL data store here. Some of the options are React, Amazon DynamoDB, but choosing a DB is based on the costing and scalability requirement, and that is something which we will cover in a different video altogether. For our current solution, let's say we will use DynamoDB. Next thing we need to clarify is how are we going to model our database. We can have separate vote counts for different TV show be distributed across different database nodes. So as you can see in this example, users are sending their votes for Friends and Office TV series onto different database nodes. But due to high load to single or some TV series, it can cause hot partition on the disk and might overwhelm that particular database storage. So here you can see that many users might be voting Friends as their favorite TV show, which will put a lot more load on this database node for storing Friends vote count. On the other hand, Office might not see that much vote count. Sorry, Michael Scott. We can solve this problem by right sharding. So right sharding is to attach random numbers to TV series name before storing the vote counts in the database. And this will spread the load across multiple DB nodes that are storing those vote counts. So we will shard our databases and then later distribute randomly the load over these shards so that we won't get a hard partition while storing these vote counts. I hope this gives you enough base on designing your own online component. We will definitely cover more details about the parameters for designing online component in a separate video. Now let's look at the offline component. As we have done our due diligence to make a robust data plane so that our users don't see any reliability issues with the website, now is the time to aggregate the votes for the admins and display the results. We can use a cron job here, or any sort of background job for that matter, to collect the sharded records. A common tool that is quite pervasive is MapReduce. Amazon EMR cluster, short for Elastic MapReduce, can be used to count final votes and store it in our data store. There are often times where new engineers get blindsided by some of the hidden gotchas. Well, keep on listening to avoid these. First up is business requirement. So in our voting application, we preferred availability over consistency while designing our online component. We did consider this approach to improve the user experience who are interacting with the system. This does come at the cost of consistency, where admins might not see correct vote counts while voting was still live. Next up is data modeling. This has majorly to do with what sort of database you want to choose and what sort of data you want to store. As we told earlier that we will cover a lot more details on databases in a separate video. But some of the crucial points that you do want to keep in mind is database sharding, SQL versus NoSQL databases, and asset properties of database. Some of the minor ones are node or network failure. This has to do with resiliency and the robustness of the system. You can check out our CAP theorem video for this. Links are in the description. Security and infrastructure cost are the other ones that do keep in mind. As we have seen in the starting of the video, let's revisit our pizza manufacturing shop once again and see how we can model that supply chain in terms of distributed systems. So just as we have seen, one guy would be pizza base maker, next guy would be toppings adder, then another guy would be cheese loader. And in the end, the pizza is ready and one guy would be the server who will cut the slices and serve the pizza. Here each guy act as microservice who perform their separate task and their combination results in the distributed system, which helps to scale the system efficiently and effectively. So let's quickly recap that what we have learned in this video. We have learned about the origin of the microservices and what the space earlier looked like and what it looks like right now. We also learned about how to model our real world problem and design it into our distributed system application. Also how to break it down into an isolated but cohesive components, aka microservices, that work together. We learned that differences between the data plane and the control plane, and in the end, we learned some of the caveats while designing a distributed system or microservice. I hope you learned a great deal about distributed systems from this video. Please let us know in the comments that what solution you came up with to solve hot partition problem and consistency issues. Also, please give us a thumbs up if you like this video and subscribe to our channel to get notifications for future content. You can head over to our website www.techtakshila.com for more detailed explanation on the video and take a fitness check. Thanks for listening and see you in the next video.